If you've ever applied to a university, you've probably had to take a standardized test. As we talked about in the previous video, the standardized and standardized test means that the score that you get makes sense no matter when you took the test, under what conditions. So how does the math work so that we could have standardized tests? The big idea is that we want to model the probability of person J getting question I right. We're going to treat this like a logistic regression. As with every logistic regression, you pass some number through a sigmoid function to make this prediction. And you train logistic regression on data. In this case, the data are a big matrix of who got what question right and who got what question wrong. In the lingo of item response theory, the questions are the items, the agents answering the questions are the subjects, and whether they got a question right or not is the response. So now, hopefully you see why it's called item response theory. The goal is to predict each of these binary responses as if it were a logistic regression. So like all logistic regression, the prediction comes out of a sigmoid function that you hopefully remember. If not, link in the description to an introduction for logistic regression. So what goes into that sigmoid function? We'll add more parameters soon, but let's start with just two, difficulty and skill. But the people, or systems, when we talk about computers, have different skills. Let's assume that we have two subjects trying to answer the questions. Ken, who's quite good, and Bert, who's not quite as sharp. The higher the skill theta, the more likely they are to answer questions correctly. On the same scale as a subject's skill is the difficulty of the questions. We'll call this beta. The higher the difficulty of a question, the more skill you need to answer it. What is the airspeed of an unladen swallow? Has high difficulty. Who's buried in Grant's tomb? Has low difficulty. So how do those two numbers feed into our sigmoid function? You take the difference between them. When the skill minus the difficulty is high, the higher the probability of the subject answering it correctly. If the skill matches the difficulty, then the subject has a 50-50 chance of answering correctly. So let's make this a little bit more complicated and add two additional terms, discriminability and feasibility. Discriminability is how well the questions distinguish better subjects from worse subjects. It's multiplied by the difference between the skill and the difficulty. Mathematically, this changes the slope of the response curve. Here's a picture of that for a question with zero difficulty. As the skill x-axis goes up, the more likely the subject is to answer the question correctly. The bigger the discriminability, the steeper the slope. Here it is for 0.5, and here it is for 2.0. This would never happen in practice, but let's imagine you could create a test where every question had perfect discrimination. Then the response curve wouldn't be a curve anymore, it would be a step function like this. So let's say you have a question with difficulty 0.2 and perfect discrimination. Anybody with skill greater than 0.2 will get this right 100% of the time. The second their skill falls below 0.2, they'll get it wrong. But if you do it once, then you could do it again. Let's create several perfect discriminators with a nice grid of different thresholds. So now when a person comes in, they'll answer every question correct until their skill is surpassed by the difficulty of the question. First question they get wrong means that they can pack up their stuff and go home early. Again, this fantasy is impossible, but you can imagine why folks want high discriminability questions. You get more information about a subject's skill for each question. Now let's see what feasibility does. Feasibility is relevant to natural language processing data since infeasible questions suggest an annotation error somewhere. Let's go back to our favorite bad question. What is the capital of Georgia? If this sort of question could have the answer Atlanta or Tbilisi with equal probability, then anybody, no matter how smart they are, is not going to get this question right with more than 0.5 probability. So hopefully you can see mathematically how the feasibility parameter lambda works. It's just a linear scaling that squishes down the maximum value the probability can take on. The normal logistic curve on top, lambda equals 1, get squished as lambda gets smaller and smaller. If lambda equals 1/2, then no matter how smart you are, it's basically a coin flip whether you can answer the question. That's basically it for IRT. There are a couple of details that are important in practice, but aren't so important for understanding what's going on. I'll mention them briefly here, but this isn't a good time to get into the details. The first thing that should trigger alarm bells for you is characterizing the difficulty theta as a scalar. Perhaps for narrow question answering tasks where all of the questions are very similar, that might make sense. But for any real test, you're going to need a multidimensional representation of skill and difficulty. Perhaps Bert knows more about potent potables than Ken, and Ken might know more about literature than he does about sports. This could be captured in a vector. This should remind you of word vectors and topic models. The same ideas apply. The other detail is how to fit the parameters. Again, the same kind of inference techniques that we use for topic models, logistic regression, and word vectors can be applied here. Given a set of responses, maximize the log probability of reproducing your training data, these item responses. To do things like hypothesis testing, you need to go an extra step and add Gaussian priors over the difficulty and skill to make them random variables with a posterior distribution that you can then ask questions about its distribution. Now that we've gone over what item response theory is, we'll next talk about how it can be useful for better understanding your data and knowing whether your system is actually good or not. This is just a single lecture from a course. YouTube likes to show you these videos out of order, but if you go to the course webpage linked below, you can see the lectures in the right order, and you can get resources like homeworks or suggested reading. You can also visit quanta.org if you want to learn about our systems for creating computers that can answer questions, where Quanta stands for question answering is not a trivial activity. If you want to help the channel, provide a big gradient to the algorithm by liking and subscribing.